And welcome to Netflix and Kill. Oh my goodness, we're going overseas again, Travis.
Yeah.
You know, I love taking a trip like this, especially a hard-nosed action kung fu trip.
Is that what we're doing today?
But you know, not only was it us taking a trip, it's actually us following a director home to his homeland. Jonathan Woo, I believe, is his full name. Now that he's been Americanized, it is now Jonathan. But speaking of some Americanized names, let's talk about who's on the mic here. Why, it's me, Nick, the Merc with a mic, and my fellow Unapologist,
Travis,
the God of the Pod himself. And of course, when we take films of, say, the Asian persuasion, we like to go to no place else but Canada. It makes the most sense to me, anyway. So, of course, we brought on Shak. Shak, say hi.
Hi, what's up? Hey. Yeah, I realize that every time I come back on here, it's for, like, a fucking martial arts movie.
Mm-hmm. Or it's some guy from South Africa taking some sort of revenge. I don't know. For some reason, you seem very weird. You don't even want to come to America in your movies, which is understandable.
Fair. It's very fair, actually.
Like, even the political climate, you just seem to not even want to escape into America. That's just, it's very telling.
To be fair, it's also just come here in Canada, at least in like, Ontario, Toronto area. We got a lot of bullshit going on, but we ain't going to talk about that. We're going to talk about some dumbass, cool-ass action.
Well, I mean, if we took about movies set in Canada, I don't think we'd have limited options. But anyone shot in Toronto, that opens up the doors a lot, I think.
True.
Yeah,
it does. But a lot of the movies that are shot here aren't good. I mean, like, they're big, but a lot of them aren't good.
I wonder, is it only one street that is open to shoot in Canada? Because every time I see movies, I always see the same fucking, like,
dude,
block of a town.
Listen, I that feel like you're thinking of is basically, like, our Times Square that they shoot it at.
And they keep treating it like it's different places. Like, oh, this is like Chicago, or this is... It's like, no, I know that place. Like,
still the same place.
The worst one for me was fucking Incredible Hulk, when they're like... This is Harlem. I'm like, no, yeah, the fuck it's not. This is Queen Street.
That's Harlem. I'm like, no, I know where Luke Cage lives. Luke Cage doesn't live there. I'm Scott Pilgrim lives there. I'm pretty sure that's where he lives.
Fucking Suicide Squad shot there. Kick-Ass shot there. There's a bunch of other movies that shot there, too. I don't remember off the top. But just, like, those are the ones that stuck out to me. I'm like, listen, I know where you are. This is not that place.
So, yeah, this is the point where we would like to have everyone remind you of Shak. He's been on before for movies like Message from the King and Kill Zone 2, which is pretty
cool. Magical Kill Zone 2.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Shak, where can people find you online if they so choose to find your online presence?
Oh, I'm in a lot of places just in the same username. So Shak Excellence, S-H-A-K Excellence. That's my, like, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, my old Tumblr that I don't even use anymore. But, yeah, just if you search that name, you could probably find me.
And you probably do so, because I've been following him a little bit this past week, and considering it's been E3, and Shak has some things to say.
A lot of things.
So, that's great. I would also remind you that you can go check our back catalog to check out some of Shaq's previous episodes that he was on for Netflix and Kill, or just some of the regular UGO podcast. I would say also you can check out our Patreon for our commentary of this film, but we actually didn't do one for this one. We're planning another one for this week.
Okay.
Well, for this one, it was like, I don't know about this. I'm not 100% sure we're going to do a commentary for this one. And... was that a good or bad decision, Travis?
I think it was for the best.
I think it was for the best, too. Because a lot of it is just, like, weird silence for this film. And what film are we talking about? Well, we're talking about John Woo's Manhunt.
Thank you.
Manhunt.
So yeah, it would be a lot of me and Travis like asking a lot of questions during the commentary.
What is happening?
Who's not getting this? Not getting a lot of answers. But let me ask Shak a question here. Shak, what is Manhunt about?
Okay,
that's an open-ended one.
Okay, I'll say the simplest part is because there's a lot of things going on in this movie.
I mean, the IMDb description is deceptively simple. Like,
the base part of it is that this lawyer for this big pharmaceutical company is accused of a crime he didn't commit, and he's trying to find a way to clear his name, uncover this big conspiracy that's happening with his pharmaceutical company, and trying to dodge the cop that's on his tail. But that's not the... There's a lot more to this, like, involving, like, super soldiers and, like,
assassins.
It's interesting,
your description didn't mention Captain America-style super soldier serums, which was interesting turn that this movie took, that I was like, oh,
that's happening now.
We're doing this now. Yep. So that's, well, that's interesting. Also,
the way they played the intro, you'd think it'd be a completely different movie.
The intro to this movie confuses me in the fact that I don't understand why it's on this movie, because it belongs in like a Quentin Tarantino type like opener for a completely different movie.
Yeah, about the assassins.
Yeah. I was almost confused. I was like, oh, so it's going to be him getting wrapped up with these two chicks, and like that's like the main storyline.
And it's barely important, actually.
It's actually kind of... is that random happenstance that they're there? Like,
I guess. I think that's what they're playing it as.
Because I guess they work for the same company, but I don't think that they were there, like, for the same... Like, there was no reason for him to be there. It was just... random.
He was just there for a drink.
Yeah, and he goes there every year, he says.
Yes.
Does he ever say why?
Not really, I don't think.
I was pretty sure. But I'm gonna be completely honest, guys. Around, I want to say the hour 15 mark of this movie, I sort of just give up.
Yeah.
I just think to myself, I don't understand what's going on. And not in the... oh, this film is so clever and so, like, and just, it's so mind-bendingly, it's not complicated.
It's overcomplicated for something that should be simple.
So there's a lot. So, you know, Shak, I would like to, I mean, it was your suggestion, so maybe go through why you suggested it, maybe some of you, like, are you a fan of John Woo's?
Yes, I'd like to say that, prefaces that, I actually saw this, almost a year ago at because they had played this at the Toronto International Film Festival, and I was like, oh hey, I'm a fan of John Woo's. Fucking Hard Boiled is one of my favorite movies of all time. I'll go check it out. And
don't even get me started on Face Off.
Oh, Face Off is a beautiful masterpiece. But I'd come in not knowing jack shit aside from that baseline plot that we had talked about, not knowing how this movie is basically the most batshit form of a John Woo movie. Like, I literally call it the most John Woo movie he's ever made, because it has all of his tropes for better and for worse. Like, dialogue is very melodramatic.
Let me talk about this opening for a good, like, I could do the rest of this podcast on this opening.
Just this, huh?
Which would be a shame, because it has nothing to do with the fucking movie. Okay. When we opened, I was off-put, and I couldn't understand why, and I still don't know if I can put it into words what it is, but I have a running theory is that John Woo has returned to, Chinese action cinema, and he brought a lot of America with him. It really does play out like a Tarantino film where they're talking about fucking movies in the beginning of this.
Yep.
Classic.
Having a full-ass meat cute about it.
Yeah, and I was just like, what in the hell? And then...
like, the one line where it's like, oh, but we can go back to my car. I have a classic movie in there.
Like, I have a bunch of movies I want to give to you. Get the fuck out of here.
Like, even the way it's shot, like, the camera angles and the kind of, like, warmer lighting, it really did, like, this doesn't feel... It really doesn't feel like... It doesn't even feel like post-America John Woo, because even that had a little bit more Woo-isms kind of in it.
It feels like he got more inspired by, like, soap operas.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, or something. There's something different with the cinematography going on here that is, like, freaking me out a little bit, and I can't really put my finger on it.
And it would only show up randomly in the movie, too. Like, it wasn't consistent. It would just, like, kind of happen at times.
Oh, no, like, there, once the, like, the, you know, thriller-type frame, you know, frame job starts to happen, it's like, oh, okay, this feels a bit more right. There's a little bit of a colder tone with the colors and stuff. Things are a little more gray and, like, you know, hard-boiled and bitter and stuff. And so these two women that we see open are speaking English.
Yeah, here's the thing. This is a thing that happens a lot where they change between three languages. They change between, I believe it's Cantonese, the Chinese language that they're talking.
Yeah.
It's Cantonese, Japanese, and English.
Well, I mean, for the main characters,
they will change it halfway through the scene without any explanation or reasoning.
Yes. So, So we, of course, it comes with the subtitles and everything, which is great. But I was very confused. Like, okay, so our main character, what is his name?
Dooku or something like that.
Count Dooku.
Darth Tyrannus himself is here.
You say lawyer man.
Lawyer Man.
Mr. Lawyer Man.
That makes him sound like a superhero, which he basically turns into in this movie.
He is.
So that,
100% is.
Like, that makes... He's so... You know what? Lawyer Man it is. Lawyer Man is teams up with Policeman, and one, you know, one speaks Cantonese, one speaks Japanese, so they... It sounds like they can kind of understand each other, but not really in their native languages, so they switch to English so they can better understand each other. Okay. I get that. I understand... But why do they keep switching back and forth?
I don't know.
But
the assassins speak very good English.
The assassins,
yes.
Like,
oh, these be great English.
The one that plays Rain is pretty good. The one that plays Dawn is like, there's almost no accent to her English. Like, her English is, I don't know if they dubbed over her. It didn't seem like it. But her English is phenomenal. Now, do you know who plays that woman?
Mm-mm.
That is
Dawn.
Yeah, Dawn. That is Angelus Wu.
Oh.
That is the I believe, daughter of John Wu.
Okay.
Yeah.
No shit!
Yeah. And let me just say this. Favorite character of the movie.
She took no shit.
She didn't.
From anybody.
So let me, let's take a sidebar here for a second. Okay. So, when I watch Asian cinema... There is a certain body type that I associate with almost any female that I've seen in...
Skinny?
Almost, like, distractingly skinny.
Like, you can actually see, like, the ribs on the back?
Yeah, like that... man, that's gross. It's like, really I don't mean to, like, be weird about it or anything, but I was super excited to see a thicker girl in this. Like, I was really excited, and plus, like... I thought she was fucking hot in this. Like, she was badass and confident, and she... did all her own, like, it looked like she did a lot of her own action shit.
Yeah.
And it was, like, really cool to see, I guess I just like him a little thick. What can I say? But she was really cool in this. So I found that very, interesting. Now I'm thinking that I figured out, because I was so obsessed with it, I was trying to figure out, like, wow, I never see anyone... Like with it, and it's not like she's fat or anything. She's
actually a normal body size.
It looks like she, doesn't throw up in the bathroom like after every meal. That's what I'm getting.
Damn.
Okay?
Wow.
I mean,
I'm sorry. I don't like. The skinny look. Like, maybe it's for some people, but I got to tell you, Dawn was the like head and shoulders above of like. She was the one turning my head in every scene of like, wow, this chick is really doing it for me. And so it was, that was pretty cool. Now I'm starting to think that, it was because like, she only got the job because she was the daughter of John.
Nepotism is a thing.
So,
but that, she did a really good job.
Yeah. She did great.
She's a great actress.
I hope she goes on to do more stuff. And I think she even directs, some of her own stuff too.
Neat.
So that's really cool. I don't think I've ever seen her in any of the stuff or any of the stuff she has done yet, but she is now on my radar. So that was neat. We've seen the one that plays Rain in a couple things. Like, she's her actress is Jin Won Ha, and I know I've seen her around in some stuff.
Okay.
Let me see. Yeah, I'm just trying to look through, like, filmography to see if there's anything I recognize.
I'm just trying to be honest, I'm trying to go through IMDb right now of these posters, and I'm like, I think I saw that.
Maybe.
But I gotta tell you, come on, like, these posters are so similar looking, and I'm like, I can't really tell. She's gonna be in a movie with, what's her name from Sense8 pretty soon, though, which is pretty cool.
Okay.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Nice.
About the North and South Korea ping pong championship, when they had a united team.
That's amazing.
So that's pretty cool. But yeah, back to this movie.
Sure.
Man, I really want to talk about anything that's other than this movie.
Yes.
Is which I'm finding right now. Okay, so I'm gonna kick it over to Shak again. Shak, describe to me your experience watching this. How did it wash over you overall?
Oh, I laughed my ass off for this whole thing. And partially intentionally and partially unintentionally. Like, the unintentional parts are mainly, like the random changes in language. Not to make it sound like offense or anything, but it's one of those things that, like, because it's so drastic and it's so unnecessary, if it added to what felt like a really melodramatic story. And to that effect, I just kind of ran with the movie. I know you said that you just kind of gave up, but for me, it was one of those things that, like, I get what this is kind of doing, and I'm just going to just run with it. I'll just let this shit just happen for
whatever.
Well,
there's a specific point in which I do give up.
also, I would just like to shout out, we haven't talked yet about the cop after him, played by Masahiro Fukuyama, who's channeling maybe the purest essence of Nicolas Cage without it actually being Nicolas Cage I have ever seen.
Damn. That is a fair actual accusation.
This man just goes in. He hams it up on a level I haven't seen in a while.
No, just the introduction for this character was fucking hilarious.
Oh, man. So he is introduced via this hostage situation where, like, I don't know.
And this whole situation comes out of nowhere. Like, it transitions into, like, we're supposed to know what's happening, and I'm like, I don't know what's happening.
You know that Mystery Science Theater joke of, meanwhile, in a completely different movie?
Yeah.
Like, there's just... and the tone of it is completely different than anything else we've seen before.
Yeah.
Like, it's these two guys, and I can't even wrap my head around this, how the scenario even came to be, because they're in front of, like, this truck of, like, was it explosives or gas or something?
Yeah, like, it was lined with explosives.
Yeah. And they got, like, this kid, and it's just two of them, and no one will shoot at them because they're of the explosives, and they might hit them, even though they're both clearly out in the open, and you'd figure that... don't, like, spray and pray, but you'd figure there'd be a sniper in the back that maybe could take care of that, but, you know, whatever. These two are out of some sort of Inspector Gadget villainry of just like, bring me a chopper and $20 million and a journalist. Let's live journal this. Yes. Or Facebook Live. That's a thing. We'll do that. And then they proceed to shoot at the presumed journalist that they asked for.
Yeah. That part confused me.
I was like, what are you doing? You just asked for this. It'd be like me if ordering a pizza and I just assaulted him.
How dare you bring this pizza?
Here, I'm here with a double extra large. Like, what is this pizza? Ah! damn it. So, he takes their asses out very easily and is just immediately signed to another case with this new rookie. And I guess the rookie is a girl, which is...
Yes.
Which is cool. Other than that, it really is just like,
meanwhile,
I don't know, like, take your pick. It's like you say Nicolas Cage. I was thinking like Dirty Harry or some other like old grizzled top training the new guy, the rookie.
The thing is, I get that in terms of the character, but I feel like in the terms of the actor's performance, it felt like a Nicolas Cage-esque performance.
No, like, you are right about the hamming up perspective.
Yeah.
Especially when, man, he plays some moments like real serious, like... I'm playing, like,
don't
he is,
smile.
Like, he does remind me of, like, cause I get, you know, Nicolas Cage will do that too, in which he'll, I don't know what emotion he'll end a sentence on, even though he started from a completely other emotion from the other sentence. It really, yeah, it, I mean, they're both, it's fascinating to watch. And so, yeah, our main guy gets framed for the murder of this chick that was, like, really into him at this party.
And went to his house somehow without...
Yeah.
I don't know how she got to his apartment.
Well, later it's revealed how she got in there, yeah. But only yeah. for us
oh
to assume...
Oh my god, that scene is fucking hilarious.
We will get to the reveal, okay? We can't... But for the longest time, we're in the dark about it. So me and Travis are like... I was trying to, like, is she his girlfriend or something?
Yeah,
like, she has really easy access to that apartment. And she's dancing on him, but he's being very affluent and, like, not really paying attention and hitting on this other chick the entire time. And I was just, like, I was confused. I was like, what the ass here? And
then, what's going on?
And mm-hmm. then some, there's the other guy who we know is evil because he's the one... Chinese guy that makes an expression on his face, so he's yes. definitely evil. Like, hey, if you ever want to know who the bad guy is in a Chinese film or in a Chinese action film, it's the guy who makes an expression with his face. That guy, fuck him. Like,
yeah.
our heroes are stoic and never even read an emotion. Like,
in fact, I don't even know if they know how to smile.
Like, you better. Maybe at one point they'll let out a single solitary tear, and that is it. So yeah, oh boy.
But like, I don't even
look. I'm there's just... like a this film is a lot, guys.
You
like,
know, you know, I'll take this. I'll guide you in this one. What
okay,
do you think about
the
overindulgence of his tropes? All of them. Like, for example, the doves. The way he incorporates the doves
so
in this movie, I cackled for a good 5 minutes straight after the scene was done.
So there's this dove scene, and when it shows up, I'm just like, oh, of course. This
I was waiting
woo.
For it. The audience applauded when I saw it.
And not only... there's this... I mean, at first it shows, like, the dove... helps him out, like, help, because our hero and our lawyer man and cop man are
fighting each other.
Because, of course, two superheroes always have to fight each other first.
Oh, yeah.
Before teaming up. Like, this film is such, it's like Captain America, the Cantonese super soldiers, Winter Soldier or something. It's just, it's crazy. So, he's got him dead to rights, and then a bird slow-mo flies between them. And I'm like, oh, of course, this is standard for John Woo. Only our hero, Lawyer Man, uses it to, like, I don't want to say deflect the gun, because that would be stupid.
Oh, no. You're missing one other part of that.
Oh, no, I'm not. I'm getting to that other part.
Okay.
I'm fucking leading up, because I'm confused at this point, but the dub shit is not over. Because I'm just like, wow. Can he control doves?
Yes, that is, like, actually Lawyer Man's superpower.
Like, that is... I thought to myself when it happened, that has to be the luckiest thing I've ever seen involving a dove. Only to be proven incredibly wrong...
5 seconds later.
Afterwards. Because, like, literally... It really is, like, literally... Like, a couple seconds after that happens, our cop man falls backwards, is about to... kill himself because he's about to fall backwards on this rock, and then another dove flies into the scene as well in slow motion, and I know he's probably just looking at the dove, and that's what makes him move his head so that it moves out of his way.
No, okay, you know what? You are missing the part before that, what that led up to, like, those doves being incorporated in the fight was when they were getting when they were chasing each other, when they were in the car. And they drive and they crash into the dove cage. And the moment you see all those doves fly out, I was in tears.
I mean, we never do see the...
I was waiting for how he was going to bring it in.
We never do see the source of the doves in other John Woo movies. I do like that. But yeah, the it really does look in the later scene that a dove has shoved his head out of the way of the rock. So, and then... inexplicably, doves are never used again in the movie.
Nope.
So, I was just like, wow, this must be him making fun of himself, right? Like,
this is 100% the point of it. That's exactly what I was trying to get to.
Yeah.
This is basically his self-aware tribute to himself.
Uh-huh.
To, like, all his super schlocky movies from, like, not, like, the Hard Boils and the Kills, but, like, kind of, like, the certain aspects that people always, like, remember, like, the more ridiculous portions of it, and just decide to overindulge in those for, like, an hour and 40 minutes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, yeah, there's also a point where our hero seems to outrun a train.
Yes, yes,
so that
does.
Happens.
Yes. That's in the first, like, yes. 10 minutes.
So I know he's not doing it, but from the way it's shot, it really does look like he's running faster than the train at some
that
point.
That still looks like to me.
And I'm just like, what the fuck? Like,
he is Lawyer Man. His lawyer powers man. Are Dove Control and Super Speed.
Once you pass the bar, you do get access to Lawyer Man powers.
Another trope that we talk about, you know, the two guns, the wedding shoot, like that shootout that's like in that like country house or whatever, when all the motorcycle people come in, like the assassins and stuff.
Holy
and somebody
shit.
Just starts sliding on the table for an incredibly long time, just shooting at anything that moves.
Including other
that
assassins.
Was just amazing.
So Dawn, or Angelus Wu, as we've talked about before, shows up during this, like I guess it's not a wedding going, it was a wedding in the flashback, but it's the same place or whatever.
Yeah.
I think they're setting up for one or strapping down for, I don't
I
know.
Think that's
I
what it was.
And she comes in on this motorcycle shooting guns, and of course
I think it was at Lawyer Man and Cop Man too.
Yeah, and then Cop Man comes out of nowhere and nails her with this with this van or whatever, and it's like the Mission Impossible trailer in which, like, she flies off, only she sticks that motherfucking
she
landing
does.
Cause fuck you, Tom Cruise. I'm gonna jump out, I'm gonna fly off this motorcycle, slide along the table as well, and shoot two guns Black Widow style. And I was just like, how is this movie not about her? This is amazing.
Fair, that whole entire set piece is legitimately great. Like,
and
the
then
way they play up the ridiculousness.
She gets hit again by a car.
And then, what else? Like, because the policeman and lawyer man were handcuffed to each other, the way they're, like, kind of doing, like, some kind of, like, almost Jackie Chan-ish kind of comedic fight style that really worked for me.
That is the best fight scene in the movie, in which Lawyer Man and Cop Man are tethered together by these handcuffs, and they have to kick down doors together and slide together and shoot together.
Like, Cop Man just forgot that there was assassins at that time when he handcuffed them together.
So yeah, that's a weird thing of just like, haha, I have you now, dude, we're being chased by assassins, maybe after that, I don't know, but no, after that he lets him go.
Right.
It's like, are you fucking kidding me? How about we didn't do this to begin with?
Also, we have not yet talked about Evil Cop Man.
Oh, Evil Cop Man. Well, it's hard to tell if it's Evil Cop Man or stereotypical, Nicolas Cage man, by the book this time.
No, pretty sure the drug-taking one was the Evil Cop Man.
Mm-hmm. Well, he doesn't become completely obvious until a little bit later.
Right. But just, like, he's the cop that actually takes away Lawyer Man and just, like, lets him go and says, like, you either run now or we kill you. And it's like, why would you give him the option?
Also, Cop Man, Cop Man is bruising for a hashtag getting on him, the hashtag Me Too. Because he's telling his new partner, this chick, like, when not to smile. Like, oh, you can smile now. It seems a little bit weird. So, God, there's so much other stuff. Like, my
there's
notes.
So much in this
we
movie.
Still haven't even touched on the super soldier shit yet.
No. I mean, so, it's like, it comes in early. We know that Dawn and Rain are, like, super.
On something.
Are super assassins, and they seem to be on something. But we don't get the reveal until later that, yeah, we're dealing with straight up super soldier shit. Mm-hmm. Like, it's even blue in the syringes. Mm-hmm. Like, it actually has been hit with Vader rays. Like, what in the hell? So, it feels so weird because they are dealing with a pharmaceutical company.
Yep.
So I guess that's their excuse for it?
Your guess is best as mine, dude.
The thing is, it transforms from like a kind of hard-boiled detective revenge action movie to like full-on sci-fi in the last third without any real, like, shit. Like, it's not a subtle shift. It just jumps.
It's a drastic shift in the type of story that we're even telling. Because I'm kind of in the, you know, maybe not quite old boy level, but like Vengeance or
well,
you know,
nothing's just gonna be old boy level
or
like of The Fugitive, kind of like I'm framed. Yeah. I need to find out who the real killer is.
Yeah, like The Fugitive. Like, imagine if Harrison Ford just all of a sudden, I don't know, like got stretchy powers, was like Mr. Fantastic, or they introduced, like, maybe he isn't chasing a one-man arm, but a man with a cyborg arm. Like, it turns out there's a cyborg arm at the end of The Fugitive. That's like, wait, what?
It's just a little off-putting.
Like, it feels like that is not the world that we were in before. But yeah, it allows them to do some weird shit. Oh, we should also mention that Rain, because of this opening sequence, because I guess Lawyer Man is the only one that was ever nice to her, is having a hard time killing him.
Yeah.
Yes.
Even though that's
she has feelings for him.
Even though that's like her whole job. Like, oh, and also like, oh, I can't kill him, so I guess I'll kill his friend.
Yeah.
Okay. Way to morally rationalize that.
But I love even more than that, just after that, Dawn's like, well, fine, you should have just said that to the beginning, I'll kill him.
Yeah, like, Dawn was like, oh, Jesus, I knew you were going to be a bitch about it. Like,
do it myself.
Can I say, and again, I reiterate, man, I love Dawn. Dawn's
great.
Pretty fun. And they shoot out from this little hole in, like, yep, that sign that just pops down. So, yeah, I'm gonna just keep kicking it to Shak, because like I have notes that just don't make a lot of sense.
Yeah,
like I mean the only like real note I have that is like coherent is, well, not even coherent, it's just, what is the score here, question mark, question mark, question mark.
Oh, the score is
it is terrible.
I got nothing.
It is all over the fucking place.
So there are like almost like half the fight scenes in this have this weird, like, almost like elevator music type shit, like with piano, and it's like, if like one step away from being like a kind of a jazzy tune. Like,
yeah,
and
but at the same time, like, it would play that for like a couple minutes and then would switch to like a dun 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 dun. I'm like, okay, so you know what's supposed to be playing here, you just don't want to.
And it's not, like, anachronistic of, like, it's not so far out of left field that it's, like, funny. Like, oh, look at this scene is playing and then this song is in the background. It's just weird and off-putting. And it's like, what, why am I listening to this sound right now during the, I mean, I don't mean to, you know, promote the stereotypical electronic dubstep during action sequences or whatever.
I mean, it's there for a reason.
But it, the reason everyone uses it, because it works. It gets your blood flowing for, you know, chase scenes and jet ski chases that happen.
Man, that was fun.
To me, that jet ski chase is really great also.
it's interesting. I'll give you that.
I like the jet skis chase, actually.
I don't know. What do you think, Travis? So what were your initial reactions here?
To be honest, this movie just felt all over the fucking place to me. Like, I could not keep track of, like, any single person's involvement to the actual movie itself. Like, individual plots, like, okay, I know why this person's, what this person's doing, I know what this person's doing, but as a whole tie-in, and like, everyone together, I have no fucking clue what's going on.
Like, when everyone comes together for the third act, I realize that, like, there are at least three different movies worth of characters in this final act.
Minimum.
Yes.
And I'm like, it's like there's the two assassins that are in their own type of universe, their own super soldier universe.
Yep.
There's the evil pharmaceutical company that might as well be run by Dr. Claw. And like, there's the hard-boiled detective and the framed man. And there's also the wronged woman that the lawyer has wronged and has to learn to like cope with that as well.
You're at four.
Yes. Which,
and it's like, there's like, there's four different movies happening here.
Then there's the plucky new cop sidekick.
Yes, the recruit.
It's a melting pot that never quite mixes together into everything. Like, all the elements are very jumbled in here. And yeah, oh God. So the woman that he meets at the party comes back later, and helps him out of a jam, and explains to him, like, oh, my husband is one of the people that that has developed the drug or whatever, and he hid the formula, the super soldier formula, so that no one could use it again. But you know, and I thought, like, at one level, like, he stole it from this one Jewish guy that fled to the America, but you know, Steve Rogers just didn't end up saving him, so, like, we lost the formula for a while. So apparently, because he did that, they go after him, not with the assassins to figure this out, but, like, lawyer him to death.
Yeah.
Which worked. They hound him so much, and when the arraignment comes down, even though he's right outside his wedding, he kills himself. Like,
yeah.
Wow. Like, that is...
I mean, yeah, I expect the deposit on that tux probably has to be paid for by his fucking fiance.
If there was ever a moment that a suicide said fuck you to a person, like, it really screams to this woman,
I don't want to be married to you.
Life is not worth it. You definitely don't make life worth it to me. I'd rather end it all right here. Yeah. So, I feel like she's going to elope next time. Like, it's just going to be like a
court. I just think she should be a lesbian now.
Like, a courtroom wedding. Like, lesbians get married too, Travis. Come on.
But she's not marrying a douche guy that's going to kill himself to not be married to her. That's a hetero thing.
I just think there's no marriage at this point. Like, she gets, you know, she gets the courthouse thing where they run in and out. Like, so, yeah, that was a weird scene. That's where I checked out in the movie. I'm just like, what is even happening right now?
Like, that whole ranch, like, fight scene, that's where I perked up in the movie. Like, oh, this is getting interesting. And then actually after that scene finished happening, I was literally falling asleep. I was like, I don't care anymore.
Damn. Also, what a weird move by a evil corporation with super soldiers is that, oh, you're not going to give us the formula, huh? Well, wait until you see my lawyer. Wait, what? Like, you have two super soldiers to, like, get his ass and like torture information. Like, no, you're gonna go through the legal process. And also they try and treat our lawyer man as, like, such a good guy. And you're like, oh, I didn't know that they were doing this stuff. And I'm like, well,
you also said you didn't care.
You
know, some shady shit was going down that you just had to, like, omit for the court or whatever.
Yeah, look, no, he actively said he didn't care. I was like, no, I just do my job. I care about winning.
Look, I get that he probably didn't know about the super soldiers, all right? Mm. But he knew some weird shit was going on.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. You got to imagine some of the legal stuff he had to take care of concerning, I don't know, disappearing people. Did we forget about that plotline,
too? Oh,
that
was totally a thing.
Yeah.
which is a plotline that gets introduced, like, in the first, like, half hour of the film and then is never brought up until the climax, to the point where, oh, yeah, these people were exist.
Yeah, because, like, as Lawyer Man's running away, he just gets involved with a bunch of bums because reasons that tell him about, hey, there's this truck that comes along every once in a while, offers work that pays very well, and they never come back. We still do it every week, though. Wait. Mm-hmm. What?
I just loved his reasoning for, like, oh, I saw you on the news for, you know, killing that woman, but I don't know, you just seem like that kind of guy to me.
You don't like a murderer to me.
Excuse me. Sir, I realize that you are entitled to your own opinion and everything, but I do want you to recognize you live on the street. So maybe your decision-making skills are not exactly as sound.
You know, a little bit of lapse judgment there.
I mean, you seem like you've been out here for a while. I don't know what that does to someone's psyche or your trust issues or whatever, but I'd be a little more skeptical. I'm just saying.
This guy just rolled really low on insight, that's all.
Oh, I don't trust that van of, like, weird people, but you, convicted murderer, yeah, you got a good face.
Yeah, except for like you. They don't trust the van, but they still go into it every week.
Well, I mean, I like the cut of this guy's jib. What can I say? Yeah, I like him. So, yeah. Shak, any other things you would like to talk about before we just head right into the spoiler sections here?
I guess we're doing just, like, an overall thoughts point right now, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, overall
thoughts. I don't know about y'all, but I fucking love this movie, man. if you haven't just guessed by like my just laughter at y'all's confusion, because it's, you guys are completely right in every single bit of the criticism that you have, that it's, there's too many characters, too many plot lines going on, and so many of them are just full on undeveloped. The third act is a fucking tonal shift that makes absolutely no sense. But for
I
those
legit thought the Hulk was going to show up,
but
or some sort of mutant like Sabretooth or some sort of like experimental monster. Like
for those exact same reasons is the same reason why I love this thing, because this movie legitimately it feels like this could have been made in 1992 and no one would have like bat an eye. It feels like one of those like forgotten VHSs that you find at like the corner of the video store. That you're just like, what the fuck is this? And you realize why it wasn't that successful, but you're so charmed by it. I was charmed and I had a blast. The action scenes, even though a lot of them didn't really make sense in terms of just like the reasoning and the plot, they were entertaining and they're well shot enough to where I was like, you know, I'm enjoying these. The whole fucking set piece at the ranch, that is, like we mentioned, the best scene in the movie because of just like how well done it is. And that's the part where like the story works at its peak in the sense of like the focus of the cop and the lawyer, how they kind of interplay with each other. The assassins, that whole shit is just funny every time they show up. Dawn, Rain and Dawn are great. Just overall, I had a blast at this thing. I don't know what to tell you guys. Like, I know you guys didn't like it, but I loved it. I give it 4 meet cutes about old movies out of 5.
Okay, so that's great. I love the enthusiasm, Shaq. And how dare you assume I know how I feel about this film? Because I'll tell you what, sir, I don't even know how I feel about it. Like, after I was done watching it, I'm like, I have no idea if I like that film or not. And then I went to work, and the night I worked the night shift, and I was thinking about it there at work as well. Still couldn't figure it out. Came home, got set up to record here, started the recording, and I'm like,
about the movie.
Afterwards, we start talking about it a little while. I'll parse through it and figure out if I liked it. And now we're here at
you
the
still
ratings.
Don't.
I don't know, guys.
Put
I'm
question
so
mark
confused.
Out of 5 or 10.
Like, just go straight down the middle, then.
I don't. I really don't, because I mean, I get that it's a parody. Like, after the dove scene, it can't be anything else, right?
Yeah.
But then they'll play some scenes straight, and then the movie feels, like, super long, but it's not really. Like, it's, and I realize, like, it's just because it's, like, there's so many things going on to a point where when they actually reveal, like, the murder, like, they flash back to the murder later, like, I legitimately go, oh shit, that's right, someone died in the beginning of this. Like, I completely forgot how this movie began. But it has like awesome elements, like Rain and Dawn are like awesome. Our main pharmaceutical guy is damn it, what's his name? Jun Kunimura?
Yes.
And he's like, you know, we've seen him in a lot of stuff. He's you know, he's a great, great actor. He's actually, anyone listening to this probably knows him from the Kill Bill movie. He's the guy that gets his head cut off. Tanaka, by Lucy Liu. And he's got a great presence. I really like him. And both our main actors, Lawyer Man and Cop Man, are pretty good in this.
Yeah, we never really talked about Lawyer Man in terms of the performance, but I think he comes off enough as a likable lead.
Yeah, I mean, we have to accept that he's got to be the most clueless lawyer in the world.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Like, because we get a peek at their operation later, and it's kind of like I'm sorry, this thing is so supervillain layer huge that there's no way
he never went in the basement, so he never knows all the dead bodies lying around.
Yeah, I have many, many, many questions.
So you're saying you bought $10 million worth of electrical equipment? Why? Well, not for torturing people. Sounds legit. Yeah.
Like, there's invoices, there's like, you know, we can't get into it. So, yeah, I did enjoy a lot of certain elements about this film, but I got to tell you, I just at certain point, I'm so baffled by what's happening and the decisions that John Woo is making. It and it's hard to tell what's it really is hard to tell what's intentional satire and what's just like, I mean, incompetent filmmaking, because that score, it doesn't feel like satire. Like, that score just feels bad. Like, it's not bad enough to where it's funny. It just feels really bad. So, Mark me very confused. Like,
that is his new rating. Very confused.
2.5 yeah. out of 5?
Straight down the middle.
I don't know if you'd like this, because normally I'm down for these ridiculous, silly movies, but I don't know if this fully qualifies as that. And I don't know if, like, if a director can actually functionally parody himself to a certain extent. I don't know. I'm you know, it's 2.5, just non-committal shrugs out of 5. I have so much to say about this movie, even though I almost have no opinion on it, which is weird.
You have everything to say and nothing to say at the same time.
But Travis, how about your thoughts overall, my friend?
Yeah, I have a pretty similar feeling with this movie, that it's got like 6 storylines and 4 acts, and I'm just like, this doesn't, like, together this doesn't add up to a coherent movie. Like, the numbers don't match. They just don't add up.
You know how Inglourious Basterds feels like 2 movies kind of squished into 1, and they don't ever kind of quite coalesce? Well, imagine that, but like there's 6 of them.
Yeah. Yeah. And I mean, individually, I'm pretty sure that like 1 or 2 of these storylines could make a really good movie. Altogether, there's a mishmash mess that I'm just like, what is going on here? I can't even remember all the plot points of how people got here. The fucking, like, buddy sidekick cop shows up randomly, like, oh, that's right, you're also in this movie, but you're not important at all.
Well, I guess that's the idea of the self-parody, is to try and shove all of your standard, like, all of his previous storyline tropes into one, and like, that's why there's so many different types of storylines in here.
Yeah, but if this is a parody, it's not a very good one, because it's a lot of like, look at all the things I've done. I'm like, yeah, what's your point?
I don't think it's a parody, as like I said, it's a tribute. To where he's just like, all right, I just want to make something just really, really fucking stupid.
Tributes should be left to other people done to you. Like, should self-tributes are not a thing that should be done.
Well, I mean, if I were to hazard a guess, like, John Woo, like, he had problems when he came over to America, let's face it.
Yeah.
I love Face Off as much as the next guy, but...
But that's the only good thing he's got in terms of just, like, his American output, because there's, like, Mission Impossible 2 sucks... Broken Arrow sucks.
So bad. Oh, God, I forgot about Broken Arrow.
Yeah.
Broken Arrow makes Mission Impossible 2 look like a fucking masterpiece. Like, it's bad.
Well, after that, that's why he went back to China and just started doing, like, historical epics and shit. Like, he did Red Cliff, which was huge. Like, he split into, like, 2 parts. I think it was, like, fucking how long? I think it was, like, a 5-hour movie or something like that. But it was... It made a fuck ton of movie, especially in China. A fuck ton of money in China.
Well, it's also a fuck ton of movie.
Also a fuck ton of movie. But I think it's just, I remember he said that, like, he's been doing, like, a bunch of historical epics. And he's like, I just want to scale back and just do something like I was doing back then. And I think it's one of those things where, like we mentioned, yeah, the tribute, your mileage may vary. And at least for me, it worked a lot. For you guys, it didn't. It just, yeah.
Well, I don't know. I mean, it feels like he picked up a couple of, like, habits or traits from his time over here in America. Like, there's, like, he never got his way to jive into in America. Like, he never got his film style to quite jive with the American sensibility or make American producers happy. So I thought he'd just go back and, like, but there's some clearly, like, you know, like, we all mentioned the opening sequence is basically, like, his... parody of, like, of all the stuff he's ever done in America, I think. Like, if I'm trying to hazard a guess at what he's trying to do there. But also, like, there's other stuff that shows up later that is just, like, so crazy ridiculous. Like, that when they're chained together sequence, that does remind me of, like, some of the better parts of, like, Face Off, like, that whole warehouse shootout.
Yes.
like, and I'm like, oh, okay, I see, like, there's... it really is like 50-50 of like scenes where like I see what he's doing here, and then the other 50% I'm like, I have no idea what you're doing here or what you're trying to get across. But I'm sorry, I'm interrupted you.
Sure. But yeah, like I said, I picked up during like the country house scene, because that was a really legitimately good fight scene.
Oh yeah,
I made no sense. I'm like, oh, there was two assassins, now there's 12. Doesn't explain why, but this is fucking awesome, so I don't really care.
Were they all super soldiers?
I don't know.
Also,
the movie doesn't explain anything.
Also, then if the dude hid the super soldier serum, why are there super soldiers?
I don't know.
Like, and then they show later, like, oh, we just couldn't get ones that were control, like, let people maintain control. And I'm like, wait, except for, like, the two assassins that definitely do have control.
Yeah.
I mean, Dawn is very in control.
Yep.
Like, she seems really, like, cold and murdery, but she's, like, in self-control. She never seems out of control. You know, we've definitely overanalyzed, and we have a whole third act to get to for the spoiler section, so we
I still have to talk about fucking finish my rating. You keep interrupting me.
I know. I'm so baffled. I don't know what to think about it.
Be baffled on your own time, damn it.
It upsets me. It upsets me.
Well, be baffled and upset on your own time. But that third act was great, and then we get to, like, this fourth act, and that's when I start just checking out. I'm like, oh god, this movie's never gonna end, is it? It's just gonna keep going. So, yeah, I'm going to give it a 4 out of 10. Like, it's just, there's pieces to a movie here. I just don't know how to assemble them. It's a movie from fucking IKEA. I don't even know what to do with this thing.
there's always a part left over.
There's a couple parts left over.
It's like, where did I go wrong in this?
Like, I don't, the instructions kept switching from Cantonese to Japanese to English, and I just don't know what to do.
It's actually pronounced Manhunt. It's a Manhunt. We are gonna head into the spoiler section then, guys,
I guess.
And I don't know, I guess we'll just talk about, like, I think we just gotta, like, I don't know, describe.
There's not much more we can talk about, but yeah, we'll go ahead, try and go, and we'll try.
So it might be short, we might go on for another 6 hours, who knows about this fucking movie.
Just like this movie, who fucking knows?
But if you'd like to check out some of our back catalog, you could do so on our Netflix and Kill episodes under the UGO Network on iTunes, or you can go to our website at unapologygeekout.com and check out some of the great content we have over there. You can follow us on Twitter at UGO Podcast or Instagram, that's the same thing, or you can give us a like on Facebook if you got the time, it'd be great. Also, you can always, you know, give us a 5-star rating if that would help us out on iTunes as well. Helps out with that algorithm. We got to beat that algorithm, goddammit. I mean, we can't keep throwing doves at it, because that definitely doesn't work. Like, we don't, for whatever reason, doves can only save people from guns and rocks. Like, that's definitely the only things that they do. Shak, one more time, where can people find you?
Shak Excellence, S-H-A-K Excellence. All forms of social media. If it's a social media, I'm probably on there.
Great.
Except for MySpace. Don't even check that.
No one's on MySpace.
No one's on fucking MySpace.
And we are going to head back into the spoiler section. We will be back right after this. I'm going. Welcome to the spoiler section for Manhunt.
There's one thing I want to mention, this is right in here. The very last scene is one thing that I groaned, but I also laughed because of how terrible it was. The way he crowbarred in the title of his own movie was like, "For a Better Tomorrow." I was like, you gotta be fucking kidding me.
Oh, did he actually say that?
He did.
I missed that.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds awful.
I believe it was the cop who said that. But fuck, I was like, I remember that line, and I was like, "You really just did? Like, you got to be kidding me!
Did you really just do that?"
So the movie coalesces after the big fight in the church ground or whatever. The cop lets him go inexplicably
for the third time.
For like I don't want to be on evil cop's side, but like, dude, you can't just let go a suspect. Because you think he's innocent. Like, there's a whole process here. And, yeah, he goes to do the whole get captured thing in order to infiltrate the evil organization.
Yeah, that's that's fucking dumb. It's fucking dumb.
A plan that immediately backfires.
Yeah, because you're going into a armored truck and then being put into a prison.
Yeah, I mean, when I saw that, I was just like, huh. That's I don't know why, but I was expecting a smarter plan.
Also, didn't they eject one of the people with the fucking super serum, so they went crazy, tried to kill everybody else in there?
Yes, our old man from the opening here is injected with the super soldier serum, but it's like the bad one that Emil Blonsky gets in the Incredible Hulk movie. So he starts punching cement and stuff.
And he's out of control, but he's still in control enough to commit suicide.
It comes and goes, I guess.
I guess.
And they're watching this, and they're going like, haha, what a successful test, right? And then I love that the guy on the other end of the Skype call is like, the fuck is that? You just made a monster. We can't use monsters. Like, oh, don't worry about it. We're refining it, and we'll make it so that it's you can get better control at it. Well, then why did you give that guy the weird formula? Like, why? Like, it doesn't even make sense just to be a dick? Like, just to be an asshole?
Just to be that dude.
Keep that in mind, because they inject so many people with the super soldier serum.
Yep.
It's like their answer for everything. Like, it's like their go-to. Like,
it's like how in Black Panther everything was solved with vibranium.
Yeah, it's not every situation calls for the super soldier serum. Anyway, Dawn is dead at this point because Cop Man killed her. Rain is feeling bad about that. And then I guess she sees what's happening in the lab.
The dungeon.
And then goes, oh, well, I don't feel good about this. Which was interesting to me because... So she's never been down there before?
I would have to assume.
I don't think so. I think it's just like she's hired, she has the stuff, and then that's it.
Yeah, okay. Except for she's like...
She gets the hot dog, but she doesn't know how it's made.
Sure.
Right, but that'd be weird if, like, you didn't know how hot dogs were made if your father was the one making the hot dogs.
Well, she said that, like, this guy adopted her at a young age and then, put her through the experiments to be a Winter Soldier. Like,
I guess?
So, like, you'd figure, like, there's this whole backstory to this.
I'm trying to justify this shit. Don't make me work harder to justify this shit.
You make the movie, Shaq. You have to justify it.
There's, like, a whole movie of backstory that they're trying to portray in this third act for these people. Of just, like, when I adopted you, like, this is not what I did. Like, have you lost your mind? No. I just got it back. And I even wrote in my notes, like, okay, that was good. That was a good line. I'll admit that. I was looking down at my notes, and I'm like, okay, I'll credit where it's due. That was pretty good. So that happens, but not before Cop Man shows up, even though he's been suspended by evil cop.
No, it's because he was suspended, because that lets him do whatever he wants, apparently.
I don't really understand his plan either. I don't understand anyone's endgame plan here.
Like, I don't even understand the villain's endgame plan, like the sun.
I mean, even, like, to go back to one we covered with Shaq before, even in Killzone 2, it feels like there's an initial plan to, like, rescue Tony Shaw. Like, it's not real well thought out.
But it's there.
But there's I'm gonna hit the lights, and then
initial action, but not any follow through.
And he comes in, and he says, like, I'll trade you the formula, because the whole thing is that they're not looking for the formula, they're looking for the encryption to the formula.
Right.
And he's like, he gives him a part of it, and he's like, aha, I have the other half, and then I'm going to need that guy if you want the other half. And they go, oh, that's the thing we've been wanting this whole movie. So, yeah, you can definitely have that guy. And then once you give us the formula, we'll kill you both, and then that's it. Or that's what a smart person would do. I don't know why, but they inject Lawyer Man with the super soldier serum.
Yep.
And I was like,
yep.
Wait a second. And then they proceed to let Lawyer Man and Cop Man fight again. And I was like, whoa, hold on a second. That guy, you know that guy is the encryption. In fact, he's the only one with the encryption. You need him alive still until you get that code.
And they don't seem bothered by that.
They don't seem bothered by that at all. And then later they're like, this formula is everything. And I was like, it wasn't 5 minutes ago. Like, I don't. I'm baffled by why they injected this guy, and then they're shocked later when they team up together and fight. It's so weird. Maybe we shouldn't have given one of our enemies the ability to kick our asses. I'm like, yeah, think.
Like, but at the same time, they're like, they have lots of guards around, and they're like, they're not succeeding in like beating Lawyer Man, but they're still there. But the son of the pharmaceutical company basically goes like, well, that's it, we're out of options, runs into the room and stabs himself with the experimental super soldier serum. I'm like,
yeah,
okay, sure,
why not? Not somebody else.
No,
not like one of the security people or like plethora of people that would probably be better at fighting than him, but himself.
Yep.
Okay, whatever. I guess he's doing this whole super shredder thing. And if we're not gonna, and if we're not gonna steal from the best, you know, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 2, that's definitely where I want to take my references from.
Yeah.
Like,
one other thing I want to mention is, I know we're just kind of jumping in and out because, well, then again, this movie is also doing that.
Uh-huh.
But, Rain's death scene. When she's like dying in the Lawyer Man's arms.
Wow.
And her last thing is just like, oh, the movies always end this way, and then dies. I was like, you still managed to make it about your fucking meat cute.
Look, we shot that opening sequence. We realized it had nothing to do with the rest of this film.
we're gonna use
the reference, damn it. and it's like, old movies, right? Like this, it's just like Casablanca. And I was just like, and I'm like, I'm like, what? I don't know what old movie ended this way for you. Like,
but it explains a lot if you took something from it.
Like, I don't remember any other movies ending.
Maybe, I guess, it's like old Chinese cinema that we don't know about?
Maybe.
Like, this seems like a very specific scenario, so whatever. Yeah, she dies the stereotypical death.
I just love how they're not like Tarantino where they're super specific with the references. They just keep it to vague old movies.
Yeah, could be anything.
Man, I just loved old movies.
Whatever you think it is.
You know, this old movie that we definitely don't have the rights to, you know, to say the name or use any footage of, that one.
That one's great. Love that one.
Okay, and I also want to talk about the apparently random use of flashback imagery in the third act. Because, yes. So, I mean, I get flashing back to the murder because I have forgotten about it. So I needed the reminder. Get that.
Yep.
Also, wow, what a weird scene. Because apparently that woman was set aside for Lawyer Man as some sort of reward.
No, I think it was more of a bribe.
Hmm? I don't know what it was. She was sent there by our main man. Pharmaceutical head. Like, she sent him there to, I don't know, maybe it's a bribe, maybe it's a blackmail thing, but she's there to sleep with him. Like, that's the original plan. And then, this pharmaceutical guy's son gets jealous and is like, oh no, so you just have sex with whoever you want, huh? Well, fuck you then. And gets aggressive.
But she also is real. She needs the fucking drugs they're making.
Right. But that must be a different drug than the crazy super punch concrete drug. But, I mean, I'm assuming because I don't think she had that one.
I mean, she got killed by a Thai, so I'd hope she wasn't a super soldier. That'd be really embarrassing.
So that doesn't track. And so he gets mad and kills her. And, yes. And then, like, oh, well, shit. I didn't think this one through. So I guess I'll just leave her here and Lawyer Man here as well, even though he has the total opportunity to defend him. We didn't even talk about this in the beginning, but Lawyer Man escapes the cops like real easy for whatever reason.
Just basically runs
away.
Like, and at first it's weird because he's like,
easy.
He calls the cops and even like has himself get around. He knows the steps. He's a lawyer. But then later he's like, even the cop tells him, hey, better run now because we're going to get you. So, yeah, that happens. But also, there's other uses of flashback in the movie, especially with our pharmaceutical head, who is flashing back to his son's death, which was, I don't know, 4 minutes ago?
Maybe that.
And I'm just like... and I really was, I'm like, wait, which... We just saw that.
Yeah, we just saw this movie.
Thank you.
just in case you didn't get it, this is what he's thinking about at this very moment.
And I'm like, yeah, he's thinking about that. I'm still thinking about that.
It just happened.
It was the last scene. I'm still thinking. Yeah, I'm thinking about that. Yeah, he said about his son. Yeah, his son died in his arms last time I saw him. So that, yeah, that's probably what he's sad about. Like, I don't. It's so weird and inexplicable that like they keep flashing, and the flashback themselves are cut in this weird like flashback acid trip type of like the camera has this wavy motion to them, to where it feels like the flashback is also on drugs, which is like weird. This movie doesn't make any sense. It flummoxes me.
It doesn't make any fucking sense, but I love it because it doesn't make so much fucking sense.
Mm-hmm. Oh, also, what's her name? His little girlfriend is here as well. I forget why
or how.
They brought her in so that Rain could get information out of her or kill her or whatever. But that doesn't happen. It end up happening. Rain gives her a gun, and this. I want to state this. She's not a cop or a super soldier or anything like that.
No, she's just a random
random civilian, and she gets a ton of kills under her belt. Like, normally you'd get the scene of like, I don't know if I could, you know, even Lawyer Man is like, I don't know if I could kill someone, and then proceeds to murder a shit ton of people. But she even didn't get that. She's almost excited.
Yeah, I wanted to do this the whole movie.
I feel like he adapted like the trope of like in martial art movies how everyone knows fucking martial arts. I think he just transferred that to guns. So we're like, if you just happen to have a gun in your hand in a John Woo movie, you could mow down at least like 30 people.
Yeah, she has no regard for human life in this last third scene.
It's a little worrisome, actually.
Like, it is disturbing how well she takes to murder. Like,
takes the murder like duck to water.
She's all about it, man. Like, it's
a new favorite thing.
Wow.
I mean, like, as far as reasons, like, this is the company that caused her fiancé to commit suicide, so I guess there is that?
Sure.
Let's go with that.
Also, our pharmaceutical, the sun guy, did die, even though our team-up happened on him. He's like our mini-boss or boss-level guy. And he gets shot like in the cheek, which I thought was awesome. Like, that was a pretty cool shot of like, normally when people get in the hostage situation, they just get a headshot.
Yeah.
I do like that he shot him like to make sure that he didn't hit her. He shot him like in the farthest cheek and then like fucked him up and then finished the job. Like, that was pretty cool to me. Is there anything else we wanted to cover here?
So many things, but
there's too many things is there's so much that we know we're probably leaving something out, that the moment we stop recording we'd be like, damn it, why didn't we talk about that? It's a mess of a movie, but it's I love it. I'm gonna keep saying that just to reaffirm my statement, just to remind myself, hey, yeah, no, I like this movie.
Oh, I also wanted to mention, I do like that he is such a monster by the end of it that they're hitting him with batons and stuff, and he's just shaking that shit off. Like, that's like, he's like, I'm like, oh, he's got like rock skin or something.
It reminds me of that scene in Shaun of the Dead when they're in the bar and they're trying to kill that zombie while fucking Don't Stop Me Now is playing, and they're just like timing their fucking choreographed baton hits.
Yeah, it's so weird. But anyway, thank you once again, Shak, for coming on and recording with us.
No problem. Sorry you guys were like more confused than enjoyed or amused by it as I was, but I'm glad that you guys got to see it, because if anything, your confusion just made my enjoyment just even better, just like talking about this.
Well, it's what we're here for.
I mean, it is weird, because normally if I'm confused and I don't understand what's going on, I'm like, man, this sucks, and I'll sit through a movie grumpily. But really, I'm legit trying to like parse it out the entire time. I'm like, I feel like I want to like this movie, and I feel like I would like it if I could just figure out some sort of key element about it.
Cipher going on
that I'm
here.
Just not getting. Like, maybe
I think it's because I refused to look at it in that sense. That like, I refuse to look at it more than the stupidity that it actually is.
And maybe going into this movie even knowing that, it might have made it better for us.
Yeah, what? That might have been. Yeah, I probably should have prefaced that, but then again, I went in completely cold, so I think it was better that you guys did too.
No, I appreciated that as well. But thank you again so much, Shak. I can't wait to see what you pick next.
I'm gonna try and not make it a fucking another martial arts movie. Try and diversify a bit.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, I mean, you got me on Nicolas Cage on the brain here, so hopefully we can get
Face Off.
Yeah, weren't we trying to get a Nick Cage movie at some point?
Mm-hmm. I think you did. I mentioned Face Off. Like,
we tried to get Face Off. That was it.
We have Face Off still on the short list now. So like this. There's that movie. Travis, have you ever watched Face Off?
I have not.
Oh my god, we almost have to do it now.
Oh my god.
I'm gonna watch it. In fact, shit. It's funny because my parents own it, and I'm pretty sure it's still sitting in their like cabinet unopened.
God, that movie's so fucking glorious. Like, imagine if a Bugs Bunny character was like a terrorist and played by Nicolas Cage.
That sounds like a thing.
It's the best thing in the world.
John Travolta doing an impression of that.
Oh, I top that. It's not only John Travolta doing an impression of him, Nicolas Cage ends up having to do an impression of John Travolta doing an impression of him impersonating himself. It goes full Cageception. Okay, so Shak, no pressure, but if you don't pick Face Off next time, you're dead to me.
We're doing Face Off.
You're fucking dead to me.
Let's make that a guarantee that next time I come on, we're doing Face
Off. We're doing Face Off.
Oh,
that's
I
it. That, there's
forward
no
to it.
Two ways about it. We're doing fucking Face Off. So. Whenever that is, join us next time for that, my friends. Otherwise, thank you so much for joining us. We are Unapologists to Geek Out and we're out.